And good morning once again, and welcome to The Other Side of Midnight. I'm your host, Richard C. Hoagland, and we have a really amazing show this morning. We reached the end of another week successfully, and we thought we'd kind of go out on an up note this morning. We're taking you back to Pluto. Before we go there, however, I want to talk about a couple of other things. There's some news announcements in the various media websites and the space channels and the folks that follow this kind of stuff. Apparently, on Monday, NASA is planning some kind of specific Mars announcement. And that announcement, no one seems to know what it's going to entail. For instance, let me read this to you. NASA on Monday will announce a major scientific finding from Mars, the agency said Thursday, in a vaguely worded press release. Mars mystery solved, the headline said. No further details are available on the nature of the mystery. However, the lineup for the Monday press conference sports top agency authorities, including NASA Director of Planetary Science Jim Green and lead scientist for the Mars Exploration Program Michael Myers. Okay. Little speculation, they're not going to talk yet about artifacts, but they are probably going to move the ball closer to the idea that there's something going on Mars. It probably involves, I mean, the major speculation in the in crowd seems to be it's going to be water, something to do with water, maybe the discovery of liquid water on Mars, which would be something of a story because the published data that NASA has given us over the last couple of decades indicates that the temperatures and, more important, the surface atmospheric pressure are too low for water, liquid water, to exist except in vanishingly small in time increments in the order of seconds to maybe half a minute, and then it would freeze or evaporate, sublimate, whatever. So we will stand by for Monday. We actually are looking at doing something on the show of a substantive nature on Monday night, Tuesday morning, I should say that. However, it all depends on what the big announcement is. Now, we've gone through some of these before, and they have tended to be kind of like, oh, is that what they think a big announcement is? I mean, they're not going to announce artifacts. They're not going to announce anything. I'll tell you what, let's see who this is. Other Side of Midnight. Other Side of Midnight.
Other Side of Hang Up.
Okay, that's curious. Moving on. The other thing I want to talk about before we actually get to our guest is events going on around Pope Francis' visit to the U.S. Did you notice today that in all the major speeches he gave, he went to Harlem, he talked to a kid school, he did he did something with the staff at the UN. He gave an address at the UN. He then talked to private individuals, political people, winding up with John Boehner. Apparently, this happened yesterday after his major address to a joint session of Congress, and it seems that John Boehner was so incredibly impressed with what happened that a few hours later he has resigned. John Boehner, as of the end of the month, I believe October, will no longer be the Speaker of the House. I believe historically this is the first time, barring such things as impeachment or, collectively being thrown out in terms of some votes in history, this is the first time that a Speaker has just kind of resigned for no apparent reason. And although he in public denied that it had anything to do with his remarkable meeting with the Pope in apparently a quiet hallway for a few minutes right after the joint session, there are a lot of pundits, a lot of observers, a lot of, those cynical reporters in Washington who are basically saying that they don't believe him and they think that the Pope had a profound influence and, in fact, triggered him to make the announcement, which he's been planning apparently to do for some time, to step down, opening up all kinds of possibilities for what is he going to do before he steps down? Could he do something really courageous? Could we actually get some joint legislation that would move the country in the direction that everyone has been yearning for in the last 48 hours or more, ever since the Pope got here, and kind of laid out what politics should be, used to be, has to be if we're going to basically survive. So, as part of these events, at the end of every one of his public addresses, and apparently including the speaker, what really has stunned people, stunned observers across the spectrum, is at the end of these addresses or these personal discussions, the Pope will turn to his audience or he'll turn to the individual, in this case, John Boehner, and he'll say very emotionally and very determinedly and very sincerely, please pray for me. Please pray for me. Now, if you heard the show that we did last night with Joe Farrell and the interview I recorded with the former head of the Vatican Observatory, you know that our model is that the Pope is deliberately doing this to invoke the physics, to invoke conscious intention, to basically then redirect that vortex in the torsion field in whatever direction that he is now trying to change, trying to affect. And since he gave a joint address and talked about real politicians are leaders and they do unusual things for the benefit of the people, the fact that a few hours later, the Speaker of the House, John Boehner, suddenly resigns, says to me that there is something profound going on. We should be paying close attention. We should not reach any conclusions yet, but we are living, incredibly, we are living in the most extraordinary times one can imagine. Okay, item number three. On our website tonight, othersideofmidnight.com, at the top, you'll see we have links under Radio with Pictures, the major Mars announcement I've gone through. I've skipped item number two because we're going to get back to that shortly. Item number three is we have a YouTube channel. Other Side of Midnight has a YouTube channel, which Ross Campbell, our producer, and Will Farrar have worked very hard to launch with our first product for free on the YouTube channel. And that is the Pluto special number two that my gang of five carried out a couple of weeks ago, which apparently is doing extremely well in terms of numbers and subscriptions and, you know, forwarding and Twittering and all the usual stuff that happens on social media when people like something. They're apparently really liking what they're seeing. So if you go there, you'll be able to see that show for free. Anytime you want, you can go look at it. Tonight's show is going to go into the archive because if we give everything away, then we can't do all the really cool things that we would like to do in future with the potential of this show. For instance, I would like to fund our EM drive engineer who's been working very hard behind the scenes to perfect a technology and demonstrate in these experiments that we could, in fact, craft a private mission and send it to Pluto, provided we had an alternative means of powering the darn thing, i.e. a workable, functioning M-drive. So the more of you folks out there in radio land who subscribe to Club 19.5, the more shekels you pour into that lockbox, the more things we're going to be able to do, like funding David to actually bring his experiments to fruition. And a few other things, perhaps in the realm of imaging, perhaps in the realm of exploring some of these ancient sites that we've been measuring, because now it's time to go and measure cathedrals, obviously. We have to companion the work we've been doing with ancient sacred sites with more modern sacred sites, and that, of course, is the subject of a program for another time. Okay, tonight's subject is Pluto. And as part of tonight's subject, you're going to hear a name and a term that may or may not be familiar to you. The name and the term is Trantor. Where does Trantor come from? Well, it came apropos of a program we did a few days ago with a couple of very intriguing guests from the fertile mind of my departed friend Isaac Asimov. Trantor is the galactic center. It's the headquarters. It's the capital of the galactic empire in a future far, far, far away or... depending upon your perspective on Isaac, maybe in a past far, far away. In any case, to introduce that concept tonight and how it relates to the stunning, and I know sometimes I overuse that word, well, tonight's imagery, as you're going to see, is stunning. Alan Stern has given us a pre-Christmas gift, and it seems to come directly from the pages of Isaac Asimov's Foundation.
Titan, Foundation. Foundation and Empire, Second Foundation. Author, Isaac Asimov. Part number one. Part title, Psychohistory and Encyclopedia. Encyclopedia Galactica, 116th edition. Entry, Harry Seldon. Born the 11,988th year of the Galactic Era. Died 12,069. Birthplace, Helicon, Arcturus Sector. He showed amazing ability in mathematics at a very early age. Anecdotes concerning his ability are innumerable and some contradictory. Undoubtedly, his greatest contributions were in the field of psychohistory. Seldon found the field little more than a set of vague axioms. He left it a profound statistical science. The best existing authority we have for the details of his life is the biography written by Garl Dornick, who, as a young man, met Seldon 2 years before the great mathematician's death.
The viewing room will be closed for the remainder of the trip. Prepare for landing, please.
Would it be possible for me to stay? I would like to see Trantor.
We'll be landing on Trantor by morning.
I mean, I want to see it from space.
I'm afraid not. If this were a space yacht, we might manage it, but we're spinning down Sunside. You wouldn't want to be burnt, blinded, and radiation scarred all at the same time, would you?
I see.
Trantor would only be a grey blur anyway.
Hmm.
Look, why don't you take a space tour once you get there? They're quite cheap.
I will. Thank you.
Right. You next?
Yes.
Right. Baggage. Lisa.
Yeah.
Right. Well, move on, Dornick. Take us to the right and third left.
Thank you.
Next.
Is that him?
Yes.
Good. Taxis to the right and third left.
Where to? Come on, where to?
A good hotel, please.
They're all good. Name one.
Well, the nearest one, please.
1.12.
I heartily recommend that you find this at our link on tonight's page. You download it, you listen. Because, in fact, if we're right, if our model is correct, what we're looking at in the imagery from New Horizons is nothing less than Trantor. I'd like to welcome my morning guest, Will Farrar, Robert Harrison, Andrew Currie, and Keith Laney. Gentlemen, how are we going to proceed to show people and demonstrate and describe the ineffable? That, in fact, everything we thought might be out there, that we imagined might be out there, that we hoped might be out there, that we feared might be out there, has come to pass. Keith?
Well, we break it down and show it to them.
Okay, why don't you start?
Okay. On the other side of midnight, I have a link to my site. And I've got a set of new pages called A Light Through the Darkness.
Okay, that's link number 5 at the top of the page under Radio with Pictures.
And then we'll proceed there. And then we're going to be looking at this nice oblique perspective shot that they gave us the other day.
So we scroll down.
It's image number 1.
Image 1.
If you click on that, it brings up a much larger image.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so they've told us that we're looking at a ice mountain range. If you're looking a little bit closer, you see it's a little bit of detail that's down there that, you know, maybe it's passed by on first sight.
So we click on this image?
Mm-hmm. Click on that image. Okay. It brings up a great big one.
Oh, my.
Mm-hmm.
My,
now, scroll around. You know, and this is a great big image. It's just covering a whole lot of territory, and it takes a while to wrap one's mind around. Otherwise, it is just a pretty mountain scene that's off in the distance.
I think it's a couple of hundred miles from one side to the other.
Yes. A couple hundred miles. Okay. And just give yourself a second to look around and familiarize yourself. You see a bunch of conical-shaped things everywhere.
Hmm.
There's one outstanding thing that you notice on it, and that the shadows are really feeble behind them.
Hmm.
Oh, wait. Those are supposed to be, under NASA's model, if we click on that large dark shadow kind of in the center of the frame, and you look at it on close-up when you click on it, it appears to be translucent.
Right.
Now, wait a minute. These are supposed to be mountains miles high and maybe 10, 15 miles thick at the base. And you're telling me that the ice on Pluto transmits feeble sunlight 1,000 times dimmer than on the Earth through 4 miles of ice, and we're seeing shadows and apparent structures against that darker side?
Right. Right. What we're seeing is really pale shadows.
Yes, and that's like, so like unusual. Silhouettes.
Right. Well, I call it a gossamer light. That's what I call it. It's like the light we're seeing that's in the shadow is just a diffused light that's passing through.
Through this solid mountain. It can't be.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. Well, you got to think how far the sun is from here, too. You know, it's illuminated with a piercing light. However, this is a light that's from billions of miles away.
3 billion miles away, and it's about 1,000 times dimmer in daylight than it is in, let's say, high noon here on Earth.
So there's no possible reason why there should be light in the shadows.
Unless
the light's passing through the obstacles that are in front of them.
Which means we're looking at inverted glass salad bowls with something sticking up underneath causing the silhouettes. And we see the light being transmitted through portions of the bowl, the glass, where nothing's blocking it.
Well, you know, you've theorized about the city under glass thing for years, Richard. here it is. It's looking at us.
Yes. And Alan Stern gave us these images without any comment. Without any comment. Okay. Let me ask Will. Will, what did you think when you saw this? And where do you want to take us? Okay.
Well, we'll start. We'll keep with Keith's page for right now. Okay. This was beautiful when I first started it. But you're right. When you come to these shadows, there's a lot of areas where it's coming through. And I started thinking maybe even crystalline quartz type glass. Same thing. I started thinking, like, how could it be? And it's not uniform. And it's supposed to be one picture, 210 miles across.
Mm-hmm.
You've got these fantastic structures throughout it, even on the top of the mountains, or whatever they're calling them, mountains, there seems to be a tubular system or something that runs through them. It runs kind of around them, and you can see it throughout the whole image. No matter where you go on it, especially if you come to the left of it, Keith's done a good job of putting this whole image up here. It's huge.
It's huge.
Out in the distance, if you look off in the distance where you've got the atmosphere, I mean, this looks like pictures we've seen on Mars. It looks a lot more friendlier than I thought it would.
Well, it's super cold. It's 300 below zero and falling.
But and sitting out there just waiting.
Just waiting. Well, the thing that's so striking to me is I predicted all this in that book that's further down on the page, Pluto, New Horizon for a Lost Horizon. I calculated that given this high inclination orbit, 17 degrees, in our model that something incredibly, horribly bad happened one day in the solar system, like maybe 65 million years ago, and there was debris everywhere, and all the planets that we see and all the moons have been smashed and smashed and smashed by trillions of particles, which is incredibly dangerous and damaging and ferocious, and you never recover. I mean, it's like sandblasting at miles per second. The only way anything could be preserved, so we could find it millions of years later, would be if it was orbiting up or below the plane of the solar system, where that kind of incredible interplanetary sleet storm did not take place. And that would have been Pluto. And we get here, and lo and behold, this is thousands of times better preserved than even I thought it might be.
It really is. And if you look directly in the center of that picture, there is a really dark, and from our angle, it looks, it's rectangular, and it's directly in the center of it. And I thought that was pretty interesting how they framed it out.
Mm.
And you can see it looks like a platform, and it's got another darker thing on top of it, and it just looks pristine. If I was going to send something, I would send right to that spot to take a look and see what we could find through there. But if you guys notice it, I've got it later when we're looking down through our other pages, we'll see it. But it is directly in the center, and I thought it was interesting. And to the right of it is a nice little perfect inclination, and it's beautiful. I can't wait to – we really do need to start sending some more probes out there like yesterday.
Okay, let's go across the pond to Birmingham. Did I do that right, Robert? Birmingham?
I think so, Richard.
Okay. Bob Harrison from Birmingham. What are your first thoughts on this astonishing set of images?
Yes. Well, the interesting thing I found about the perspective shot is it seems to be more revealing than the overhead shots of the same area. Perhaps because we're seeing the more central part here.
Well, we're also more used
to a higher resolution.
Yeah, we're also more used to seeing perspective shots. It's rarely that we, in an airplane, can even look through the floor and look straight down. So you look down at an angle when you're flying along, and you look at Denver, L.A., or, you know, Flagstaff, whatever, and you see perspective. I mean, this looks like you're flying at a very high altitude on Earth in an airplane, high enough to actually see the curvature of the Earth, which means you're really high. But the stuff appears familiar. It does not look like mountains. It looks like architecture.
Well, there are some there's a complexity to the side of some of these things. As somebody was saying before, you know, you've got, it seems like these weaving sort of pipe-like ridges in some of the image. You've got some rectilinearity that you don't see in the overhead shot in some of the non mountain areas on the relative flat areas.
Mm-hmm. You mean out on the surface of this thing that looks like a lake with ice on it?
No. That really looks like a frozen sea now, doesn't it?
Doesn't it?
I know the surface is frozen gas, but...
water, if you boil it up hot enough, is a gas, and then it becomes a liquid, and it becomes a solid. So you're just looking at the phase state changes of materials that on Earth are never solids or liquids, like nitrogen and carbon dioxide and methane. I mean, the temperatures here are well below 300 below zero, getting down even closer to absolute zero. So, I mean, this is such an exotic alien planet. And then you've got these things that look like huge mega architecture plunked down in patterns. Who in their right mind would live on Pluto under these conditions? And the answer has to be, these conditions are not what Pluto all the time has experienced.
Well, in the sort of central part of the image that the eye is drawn to, you've got almost like two rows of what we're being proposed of as arcologies running parallel
to each other.
Parallel to the coastline, as we'll call it, of the Sputnik planum. Just noticing there on that part as well that there are cliffs where the shoreline, as we're calling it, is joining Sputnik planum on
part right in the center of the image.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a definite. You can see that the lower area is actually overhanging.
Mm-hmm. And you can see shadowing underneath.
the underneath, yes.
But it's not pitch black, Bob. It's actually gray, indicating that it's getting scattered light from somewhere. Is the surface light on Pluto because of the atmosphere much brighter than we're thinking it might be?
Well, well, it's supposed to, be very thin, isn't it?
Very thin. Microbars, I guess, a millionth of an atmosphere, something like that. Okay, let's bring in Andrew. Andrew, come on, rescue us. You're the artist. You're used to turning two-dimensional imagery into 3Ds for movies and television. Save us and tell us what we're seeing.
Hi, Richard. Nice to be on the show again. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Well, when the first time I opened this image,
okay, where do you want us to look?
Oh, okay. The same image. Okay. Just to start off there.
Good.
So still on the big wide. When I first opened this picture, when it was, I think Keith sent it to me, or Richard, you might have, I was stunned. It was beautiful. And, I have an 8-year-old son, and he walked in, and he saw it too, and he goes, Daddy, that is beautiful. This image. And then when I got closer, so now we can go to some of the imagery that I was working on. Now, if you go back to Radio with Pictures,
okay,
and you go to number 6, we're going to go to number 6 first, just because that's the first take I had of Pluto and the arcologies that we believe we're starting to see. Now, this piece I did basically listening to you and Bob and Keith talk about what we might be seeing on Pluto. This was, I think, a couple of months ago.
Mm-hmm. God, it seems like it's forever ago.
Yeah, I know.
We've learned so much new. I'll tell you what, hold it there, because we've got some music here at the bottom of the hour, and we have a break coming up, and I don't want to eclipse any important thing you're going to be saying. So tonight what we're going to do is we're going to feature some more tunes from a gal named Amanda. Amanda's written something that I thought was really appropriate. It's called Some Days. I want you to listen to this. Look on your device at Andrew's perspective shot of the first arcology that we limbed out months ago, and just think about what the words mean. Some days. And we're back on the other side of midnight. My guests this morning, Will Farrar, Robert Harrison, Andrew Currie, and Keith Laney. And we're analyzing the latest images from Alan Stern from the New Horizons mission. And we just started looking at one of Andrew's 3D shots, his perspectives on what the 2D imagery looks like. And we had to interrupt ourselves, so we shall return now with Andrew continuing describing an arcology on Pluto.
Okay, great. So, again, back to Radio with Pictures. And then we want to go to item number 6, it's called the sci-fi surface, so we'll click onto that real quick. So this was my first little stab at what we were starting to see via the data coming from the New Horizons satellite. And I did a lot of this based on what, again, you and Keith and Bob as well were talking about, Richard, on that particular night when you guys were reviewing this information the first time. And looking back now, I realize I would do things differently.
It's awfully close to what we now know.
Yeah, no, it's true. And it's funny because a little later on, I want to review some of the stuff that we're seeing, like on the imagery, on the footprint, looking back.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things that I noticed very early on in this piece, and I know I'm moving from this from a very intuitive place, but and it's something that Keith said on his website. He talked about how this structure is very, very tall, but it also seems very, very deep.
Hmm.
And this is a quality that I somehow instinctively knew when I was drawing this thing. Was that,
so are you saying the inside is bigger than the outside?
I'm Well, I just had this feeling that it is anchored very, very deep within the crust of the planet. And it was a sense I've got. And we've had these discussions. I know, Richard, you mentioned something which I thought was very key. And I know we were looking at some of the pre-mission art, and we noticed that there was almost an evolution of the surface of Pluto in that art. I mean, it was an artist's conception, and you know, we don't really know what the message there was. It was beautiful, though. But you made a comment in one of your emails to us where you said, it's almost as if this architecture is growing. Mm-hmm. Like it's almost, yeah. And that
in the ultimate definition of the term organic architecture.
Exactly. And that another term you use is that the people that inhabited these structures were almost living symbiotically. And I just found that a very striking image. In fact, you know, as I started to draw the images that when and in fact, why don't we go to them now? So if we go to back to Radio with Pictures and then click on number 7.
Okay, so we scroll down to
down.
7.
Yeah.
Light through the darkness, figure 1.
That's correct. So what I did here on the next 3 vignettes, I kind of storyboarded the work this time. I didn't go into a big elaborate piece, partially because I wanted to do so much. I was really overwhelmed when I saw this image.
Gosh, I can't imagine why.
Well, the more stuff that came in, the more I just started going in, because I know when we look wide and we come in on some of these images, we see a lot of things. But if you go really close, you start to see repeating geometric shapes. You see like ribbing on all of these great arcologies. There's like a regular ribbing on the top of it, which to me again talks about buttresses. It talks about a central spine to these things.
Mm-hmm. It talks and structural engineering.
Yes, exactly. So what I wanted to do in this piece, this figure 1, was to pick up again. I was shadowing. Excuse the pun. I was shadowing Keith on his presentations. Now, we haven't actually gone to his work yet on this one, I don't think. But what I wanted to do was to show the translucent quality of these arcologies.
Mm.
So if we click
you
on
understand,
it, get a little
closer. Guys, everybody listening, this is impossible if these are mountains. I got an experiment. Take an ice cube from your freezer, okay? And take a candle or a cigarette lighter, hold the ice cube between 2 fingers, darken the room, and light the candle or the, you know, match or the cigarette lighter on the other side of the ice cube, and then just kind of look at the back side of the ice cube with the tiny, tiny, you know, flickering candle or lighter on the other side, and you'll see that even a few inch wide ice cube stops light. There's no way that a mountain, a mile wide or a 10 mile wide mountain, 4 miles, 5 miles high, made of ice, even if it was ultra crystalline pure ice, would transmit the feeble sunlight at Pluto's distance. There has to be mostly empty space inside this cone, with the glass or whatever's keeping out the vacuum relatively thin, so the light enters the inverted salad bowl, goes past the structures in the center that cause the shadows, the kind of vague, softened silhouettes, and then exits on the dark side, still bright enough that you can see it with the cameras on this spacecraft, which, by the way, were optimized for taking very short exposures. Otherwise, the motion, the 35,000-mile-an-hour motion past Pluto, would have smeared the images, and you would have lost all the data. So these are snapshots, and still you're seeing the mountains, quote, transmitting light. No way. This is another physics, another dimension of architecture, not nature.
Exactly.
And end of rant.
No, but you're exactly right. And it was one thing that Keith and I spoke about right off the bat is that we noticed that there is a silhouetting right towards the bottom of these amazing structures. And you know what it is exactly. I mean, I'm conjecturing here buildings, spires, these kind of thing.
When I first went to work with Cronkite, which was back in 1968, in the spring of 68, they called me. I answer the phone, and the guy said, "Hi, my name is Bob Menezes. I'm associate producer of CBS News Special Events. We'd like you to help us go to the moon." And I said, you know, like Cosby, remember, who is this really? Because I thought somebody was obviously playing a joke. When I fast-forward the film, when I went and actually had my first lunch with all these producers, and we're walking up from the CBS studios toward the I forget what the restaurant is further at 57th. It might have been the Russian Tea Room. Anyway, we're walking up. It's a gorgeous, beautiful spring day. The sky is deep blue, bright little fluffy clouds, sharp sunlight. And I brought up Paolo Soleri, who was the Italian architect who right back then in the late 60s had proposed putting huge glass domes over all the major cities on Earth to basically protect the environment outside from the awful effects of too many human beings. So I started telling these guys that someday one might imagine this walk in any weather with perfectly controlled weather because there'd be this huge dome over New York City. And they all stopped in the middle of 57th Street. They turned around and looked at me like I had landed from Mars. But that's what we seem to be seeing. New York, something the scale of New York, the island of Manhattan, 10, 15 miles long. Almost some of these things are probably 20 or 30 miles long, with a dome over it, with a city inside, that maybe someday we can go there and walk inside and find the switch and turn on the lights and the air and the heat and all that, and whoever lived there will tell us who they were in the form of the libraries.
Yeah, that's a topic I've been, or that's a subject I've been thinking about a lot lately, Richard.
As you cannot help looking at these pictures.
Yeah. No, it's been resonating. And when you and Dr. Farrell last night were talking about maybe some of these libraries are located in on our Earth in the Middle East.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's interesting. That's interesting. I wanted to point out one more thing about this particular piece. If you kind of scroll over to the left, you'll see and this is, again, Keith brings this out in his...
Oh, the pyramid, the white, bright pyramid.
Yeah.
That's on Keith, the real image. That's stunningly apparent on the real image.
Oh, we'll be saying that, trust me.
Yeah. And this is what I mean, is that not only are we seeing these ghostly, incredible, beautiful, haunting silhouettes in these magnificent domes, but all through the landscape, we see lines and repeated shapes, and we see walls. I mean, this is what I'm seeing, and I mean, again, you know, Richard, you've brought me on, I presume, to help our viewers begin to understand the model that we're discussing here.
Mm-hmm.
It's you know, we're not there, we don't see it, but if you look closely. I mean, this looks like the coastline. It could be the coastline of Miami.
See, the way to do this is to have your images on the screen racked up left or right, and then the actual image, the actual New Horizons image, side by side to the same scale, and you look back and forth, and what you'll see is that Andrew's educated eye can become all of your educated eyes. You just need to kind of lift the blinders that say, oh, come on, this is impossible, this is real, NASA'd be telling us. No, they're telling us, like Emily Dickinson, tell all the truth, but tell it slant. They can't come out and tell us because they're frankly afraid. They're afraid of what might happen, so it's soaking through, and I think we're the designated hitters to try to explain the implications of these stunning images.
Very interesting. Now, Richard, do you want someone else to come up to bat now, or do you want me to keep going?
No, keep going, because I think the perspectives...
Okay.
Then we'll go back to Keith so that we can talk about the real imagery compared to your perspectives on the real imagery.
Okay, so if we go back to Radio with Pictures, we go back to that, and we scroll down to number 8, which is just underneath 7, of course.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that logical?
Okay, so...
Got it. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. And each of these are not distributed at random. It's like you have mega cities organized into a super, super mega cluster, like we've got mega clusters of galaxies and the universe and all that.
Yeah.
These people seem to like community, but on a scale that is almost unthinkable.
Go ahead. Well, this brought to mind a couple things. As I was sort of drawing this, and I want to make another point. If I was to take an image of the Antarctic or somewhere in the Arctic and start just randomly drawing ice mountains or whatever, I really don't think I could come up with the elegant or the elegant structures that I've been able to pull out of these NASA images. I mean, I've been drawing since I can remember, since I was very, very little, and I know I'm a pretty creative person, but there's just no way that I could come up with these designs just out of pure, you know, speculative ice mountains. I couldn't do that. And what I noticed, and I was going to ask you about this, Richard, is that I almost get the sense that there's a plan here. I mean, it was just a feeling I started to get that there is a deliberate organization here. And one of the things that I noticed is that on the big view, there is almost a rhythm to this. I mean, I understand a lot of it's devastated and it's been covered with, you know, dust and ice and, you know, whatever else happened to it when it originally first took its battering. But it reminded me when I was drawing these like cutaways of kind of like Jackson Pollock paintings. There was a study done about Jackson Pollock. He's that famous American drip painter. That if you stand back and look at his paintings, they actually did a calculation of how he does his spray, his sort of splatter lines.
Mm-hmm.
But if you go down to like an inch, you get exactly the same vectors, the same math that his big one, his like the overall size is. And it's the same feeling I have with these architectures and these structures, is that we can go large and there's almost like a rhythm to it. And then if you go down close, it just keeps repeating this pattern.
So you're saying it's fractal.
Fractal.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. And
now
that
can be two. We can look at that two ways. One is nature creates fractals, meaning subsets of the same pattern going down, 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 or up, depending on wherever you start. Organics, biology, is wonderful, stunning at creating fractal patterns. But intelligent architects, designers, also create such patterns because they're mimicking the natural patterns inherent in great, great architecture like the Golden Mean, et cetera, et cetera. So you all wind up at the same place. So the fracticality, is that a word? The fracticality is not a ready indicator that this is artificial or natural. So you got to get closer, because the fractal organic big geometry for me, and you can disagree, Andrew, if you see something different, but I see so much rectilinearity at the small scale that's more Euclidean, and nature does not create Euclidean geometry.
Mm. Yeah, well, I think anything is – I think it's all wide open. I just know that one of the other qualities about this
– So wait, you're saying that we actually could be looking at super big organisms frozen in time when the catastrophe hit Pluto?
Well, this – again, you know, we've had these discussions. I mean, I get the feeling that these people were very close to the land.
Mm-hmm.
I just get a feeling –
When it was not at 300 below zero.
No. Then that's what I mean by my comment about the Miami coastline, is that there is, I mean, like Bob said, it looks like a frozen ocean.
Mm. Exactly. By the way, guys, look, you can jump in at any time. This is supposed to be a conversation. If somebody has a point or a question, I'm not the only guy with questions. So, you know, mix it up. Keep it interesting. Keep it clean.
Yeah, I noticed you captured the bilateral symmetry between the different sides, because that particular area is sort of laid out in a diamond, and actually a square from overhead, but from our perspective, it's a diamond. But if you look, there's two of a certain type on this side. There's two of a certain type on this side. There's one big one back in the back. There's one big one in the front. There's, if you look, they're juxtaposed, and it comes out with it makes for a nice scene that's hard not to notice.
Well, Keith, you made a really extraordinary comment when you said, and I think you wrote this on your site too, and everybody really should go and read.
Oh, yes. In fact, I'm going to actually go read it. Let me go do that right now. How do I get back there? Light through the darkness. I've got too many windows open. Okay. let me do this. Okay. Come on. Okay. There we are. Okay. Because this is really, really intriguing. All right.
Yep.
See, it's not often that I, as a wordsmith, admire someone else as a wordsmith better than I admired my own wordsmithing. But Keith has written something that I really think you need to see. So everybody go to Radio with Pictures, click on Keith's first image on his link. What's the number on the page tonight? I haven't got that up. Keith?
I think it's number 5, isn't it?
Number 5? Is that Keith's the link?
It's the last one. It says A Light Through the Darkness.
Ah, that's it. On number 5, okay. And then kind of look at this image as I read the following. That the location is painfully beautiful goes without saying. It is so much, so you could say it is heart-rending. This is for no mean reason. I sincerely hope you took and look at the larger version of the above image because it is big, highly detailed, and quite a thing to wrap one's head around. A quick perusal simply is not adequate for much of this detail to set in your mind's eye until the natural pattern recognition inherent in all humans starts working and grasp the enormity of what it is that this is showing us. This is a magnificently beautiful destruction, spread wide open before us like a newly discovered ancient crime scene, heretofore untouched, all evidence untampered with except by the hand of time. A mutilated corpse on our autopsy table, laid out for forensic investigation and backlit by an extraordinarily penetrating and eerily revealing light which pierces through the darkness within. The origin of its demise is quite unknown, evidenced only by the wounds inflicted upon it by its destroyers. On this page, I'm putting forth the idea that we're looking at a graveyard pile of bones, rubble, technological debris, and crumbling gargantuan constructs of a type almost frighteningly unbelievable, even to our present-day, highly desensitized, multi-generational level of post-Brookings reports of social and cultural extraterrestrial conditioning. To exonerate us and to orient us, the next thing I'll be displaying is a footprint map of the view shown in this photo, made with images taken on approach from nearly the opposite direction. The map image is superb in its own right and shows these same features in a different context and lighting. It is very useful for comparing items to its counterpart above. Really great writing, Keith.
Well, thanks. But, you know, but when you have great material to write about, the words just come.
Yep. The one word I'm thinking of as I'm looking at these for the last days and days and days is Trantor. Was Isaac really describing Trantor in a romanoclef, a stunning romanoclef, basically written to put on paper and archive at a mark in time the idea that this is not what we will someday become. This, in fact, is what we used to be. And what we, if we figure out who we used to be, we can maybe be once more.
That's amazing. It's the arcologies that are down there in these images are, you know, they're truly, truly stunning.
Okay, so which image do you want us to go to?
Okay, now you see on the footprint image, I've showed which direction that we're,
which is image number 2.
Looking back on, yes, it's number 2. And I mean, if you want to, you can click on that, but it's just a larger version of the same image. It's pretty nice.
Mm.
Okay, and if you go to image number 3. You will see where I've taken both those images and put them side by side, and I've numbered some of the features on them in both so that you can see what they look like front and back.
Amazing. Amazing. You know, at this scale, it looks kind of pristine, but when you get really close, you can see there's tremendous rubble and tremendous destruction. And yet,
oh, yes.
It's still so big and so massive and so awe-inspiring that even though you're looking at planetary-level destruction, whoever built this stuff built it big enough that it still survived.
Yeah, and its shattered shells are all over the place. All it takes is just you got to look. You have to recognize what you're seeing. And the thing that gave it away to me was the geometry. Like Bob was saying, the double rows of pyramids.
Mm.
Going, come on, man. That's you know how much that reminds me of Teotihuacan?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I mean, of course, this is on a slightly more gargantuan scale.
Or, you know, have you seen the skyscrapers lined up in downtown Dubai?
Yes.
That looks like a mega, 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 you know, South Miami. And, the scale of this is like 10 to 100 times that.
Well, as you get closer, you know, what I wanted to do with when I started looking at it was so much to soak in, to see at one time, because this is a big area and there's so much detail down there. I decided that it would be easier to break it up into pieces and then present it individually, so it gives your mind, it takes the distraction of the rest of the image out of your mind, so you can focus on small areas.
Okay, let's go to Will, because Will has prepared his own pages on this, and I think he's found a few things that the rest of us didn't quite find. Will?
All right. If we're going to stay on these two images right here, if you want to, guys, going to go back and open up. Let's see, there's two more images that have been put out since this image, and that are absolutely gorgeous. The color image that they put out at the mega scale.
Right. So where should we
let's
go?
Let's go ahead and let's go back to the page Radio with Pictures.
Okay.
And then Pluto Comes Alive, which will pull up my website. And you've got the four at the top. You've got the links for anybody who wants to get them directly from NASA. A lot of times I find that useful to give to people.
Okay, so hang on. We're at Radio with Pictures. We click on link number four, Pluto Comes Alive. That takes us to your page on Pluto tonight.
Yes, okay. And then we can scroll on down. I like to start with image two because that comes from the same image that we've pulled these others from. And as you can see out in the back left hand, this is when you're looking out on the horizon.
This is image number two on your page.
Yeah, it's right under image two,
okay.
Right there. And what I find, and like you said, when I like Keith did, I tried to pull these out in small pieces because when you look at that huge picture, it's so awe-inspiring. Your mind just wanders all over it. So,
oh, there's some staggering geometry in the center of this one.
See it there, and it's not only is it directly in the center, you've got it all around it. Up on the top towards the left, you've got rectangular, what looks like huge arcologies with the tops open of it. You can see there's almost a ridge that lines up there. You've got two right next to each other, and I might even be a third one down under it to the left. That kind of matches up with it. When you're looking at something that's destructed like this,
yeah, we're looking at image number two on your page, right?
Yep, image number two, and I'm at the top left of it right
now.
Oh
yeah, way up there on the top left. Okay.
Yeah, and you can even see that the rectangles and the geometry are oriented the same.
Yeah, that looks like huge vertical buildings with floors. With the sidewalls gone, so you're looking at the internal geometric guts of these things, but the scale has got to be 15, 20 miles long, at least.
Yeah, imagine.
And maybe 3 or 4 miles high.
Exactly.
But they're vertical. There's no talus. There's no angle of repose. Those are not mountains. Those look built.
There's no way they could be mountains.
No.
At least not in the form that we know mountains here on Earth and here on Mars. And if you want to scroll on down to image three.
Okay, so we go back. All right, so we get rid of that blow up and we go back to your page. Image number three.
Yeah, and you can click on each of these images and it brings them up into another.
Mm.
If you just want to get rid of the page part and come back, it opens up another window. And this is one where I've actually oriented it a little bit better so you can see along the ridge. But this is the on the main image, if you were to look at the big one, this is a little bit more center of it. And you can see the same things as you just kind of come across from the bottom left up to the bottom right, just like a rows and rows and rows of rectilinear. You've got what seems to be going into some of these. You seem to have this huge piping or something. I'm not exactly sure what it could be. Sometimes I think a lot in Earth terms, where I've got to get my mind out of that Earth mindset because these are so huge and so distant, so different than what we've built.
Well, wait a minute, though. There is a form follows function idea, kind of a rule of thumb. For instance, if you have billions of human beings in these arcologies on this desolate, remote place, how did they go to the bathroom? Plumbing is a huge part of keeping civilization alive. And if you have billions of people, you're going to have commensurate larger conduits than if you had millions. I mean, look at New York City. most of New York City is underneath. If you could take a CAT scan, a slice of New York City, you'd find a tremendous amount of plumbing going on unseen and underneath. Well, the same with any three-dimensional creatures living through metabolism as we know it. You've got to have input, you've got to have outflow, and you got to have plumbing to take care of all that.
That's beautiful thinking there, and you're right about New York City. There's more under New York City than above it.
Yep.
In many ways, and I think that's where we have seen a lot of that here, especially on Pluto. The pictures from here have just been tremendous. Now let's go ahead and close that one up.
Okay.
And I wanted just to come back down. We're going to stay. These are some of the ones, Keith, image number 4 and 5.
Mm-hmm.
They're the same areas. They're just a little bit more wider. I brought them out. You can see down there in the middle of image 4 is where the that big rectangular type structure is,
right,
with the top
right.
open. And that just gives you a little bit more wide view of where it is out on the image for everybody.
I love
image 4 has a skyline on it that would rival any on Earth.
Absolutely. Okay, guys, hold it there. We got a break coming up. My guests this morning, Will Farrar, Robert Harrison, Andrew Currie, and Keith Laney, were describing and discussing and looking at an extraordinary possibility. Ancient structures on Pluto. Ancient megastructures. Ancient megastructures from a civilization that's so far above ours as we are above field mice and ants and shrews and other creatures that simply make holes in desert floors. This is something to contemplate. And obviously, someday, we must return. Speaking of returning, you're on the other side of midnight. My name is Richard C. Hoagland, and we shall return as well, right after these messages. And we are back on the other side of midnight. Will, you were leading us through your page and taking us on a tour of an extraordinary place, fully deserving of the term planet. Please continue.
Yes, a planet, fully deserving. I think we should go back and hopefully look back and take a look at that again and give us its full. So we were looking at image 4, the skyline there, and Keith was right. It really does look like any skyline here that you would find on Earth, except it's in black and white, which we don't have the full color. If we moved on down to image 5 on my page, if you're just joining in.
I love image 5.
I love the perspective from they've given us, because you're right. When you're looking out of an airplane, what we're so used to seeing from our even just using Google Earth and things like that, a lot of perspective. And the perspective of this is almost – this was way up at the top of the image at the skyline. So you can see that the darker part, if you actually click on the image, it'll come up and the website itself will go away and you can see just the image.
Well, just kind of eyeballing the geometry, if this image was taken about 15 minutes after closest approach, you're barreling past Pluto and this little tiny gold-plated insect called New Horizons, about the size of a baby grand piano, frantically taking images, frantically swirling around so you can point spectrometers and other instruments at various parts of Pluto and Charon. In that 15 minutes, the distance to the horizon in this shot probably was more than maybe 10,000 miles. So you're looking at structures that are as big as cities photographed across the width of 3 continents the size of the United States through empty space, and I see 3 pyramidal arcologies in the foreground in this clipped image. And then in the background, way out and toward the horizon, there's a possibility of a fourth one, dim and out of focus and no detail. But they've plunked these things all down all over the surface. Like, there's almost, in some of this, there seems to be a lack of planning. Like, these were temporary housing. Can you imagine temporary housing the size of mountains?
It could have been needed. Very well needed to build these mega cities at certain times. And if you think of if they had ships that could move in and out, I mean, they mean staging areas, just like we talk about using our moon as staging areas and putting small – we're looking at putting very small pieces, but if they obviously had the technology to do it. And I love that little dome you said. It's kind of just off in the distance.
Yeah.
It looks almost like a dome. but it has like that translucent effect to it. Yeah, that really pulled me into it. Wanted me to clip. That made what made me clip that image and especially put it on tonight's show.
How can you look through a mountain? You can't. I mean, the Sumerians, and I think the last time we talked about this, I misspoke. I said it was the Egyptians. It was the Sumerians who had the specific term, Ikur. And the translation is house like a mountain built. How do the Sumerians 6,000 years ago confined to one planet, you know, here in the Middle East, how did they know what we would find in the opening decades of the 21st century? Unless they had archives, records of their own history.
Well, we know that they have existed. I think somewhere on our planet we will find them if you've followed people like Edgar Cayce and getting into that part of it.
I don't care if we find them on the Earth. I got to get to Pluto to find them. I know they're there. You know,
on us.
There's only 3 billion miles in between. Come on, let's go, guys. You know.
Yeah, if
David,
they're not there, there's
David,
enough stuff there we could figure them out.
Yeah, work faster, work faster. We need a drive. Okay, well, where are we going next?
Well, if you guys want to go ahead and move on down to the latest images that we've got, if you go back to my page, if you're just joining us, the Radio with Pictures, you click on number 4, Pluto Comes Alive, it'll bring you to the What's Up in the Sky website. And we're going to go down to image 6, and this is the snakeskin image that they've given us. And now this is a clip from the huge image of Pluto, I think, that they've basically clipped out. That's the full image number 6 that we got for it.
It's the upper right-hand limb. That's the day-night Terminator line. And as you get closer to the Terminator, the shadows get longer and longer, and small surface relief is more accented. And if you scroll down now to number 7, this is a close-up of number 6. Will, what the hell is that?
I know you're looking most likely exactly where I am. To the center of the picture, if your eyes go up just a little bit to the left, the geometry is absolutely amazing in it. You're looking at rectangles, almost looks like if you were to sit a bullet down on your, you know, the 9mm bullet on your piece in front of you, the geometry looks just like a bullet or something along those lines of that area.
I would say a three-dimensional scaffolding, because this is not 2D, this is 3D, and you're looking through it at an oblique angle, and you're looking at eroded scaffolding. You're looking at structure. You're looking at geometric constructional elements of a vast set of ruins that go on this image for hundreds of miles.
Has anybody...
Rob, go ahead.
I was going to say, has anybody seen the this large rectified picture?
Of the so-called snakeskin?
Yes, there's a second picture with the snakeskin in it. It shows a more extensive area. It's a colorized image, and it includes things like the arcology row on one side of Sputnik Plain, and then the other shore of Sputnik Plain where this snakeskin area is. And there's parts of the snakeskin that are very rectilinear, you know.
Mm.
So this part, I think... this is like things have been foreshortened in this image because it's near the limb of the terminator of Pluto.
Right.
But it's a very strange sort of triangular thing. Everything at the top of the picture is very distorted. Mm-hmm. You've stretched out like a Mercator map. But the bottom...
do you get any sense, Bob, in looking at this image that we're looking at epochs or eras in the evolution of Pluto as a planet? Do you understand what I'm...
Yes, ruins and...
Well, I'm looking at this stuff, and these look like mega ruins that are the actual crust of Pluto. The actual exposed guts of how many miles of the upper surface of Pluto scraped away and exposed and eroded and bared to space so we can see it.
Right. Well, in this bigger perspective shot, the...
Are we talking number six?
No, I'm talking about the one we can't all see. But probably in what's up in the sky...
Okay, if you scroll down to number eight, there's the full image, which these are blow-ups over on the right-hand side of the limb.
Right.
If the image is not available in Will's file, we probably shouldn't talk about it because people can't go find it.
Yeah.
But the vibe is getting at, tell you what, Will, why don't we go to number eight, your number eight, and just kind of look at that for a minute. When you look at close-up portions of number eight or an image like number eight, and anybody join in, I think I'm seeing different epochs and eras of the inhabitation of this little place. Remember, Pluto is only 1,500 miles wide. And the question then is, who built the first stuff, which basically is like Trantor? It is the crust. And if we scroll way down, Will, let's go way down on your page, down to number 12. Okay, everybody down there?
Yep.
Okay, and if you click on number 12, that gives us a full view. That looks like the almost preserved part of the crust of Pluto when it was like Trantor, meaning it had depth, it had breadth, it had multiple levels and layers and decks, and how far down it went, we don't know. It's now been rifted in parts. It's been separated by huge tectonic forces. Obviously, if you move a planet, maybe everything doesn't move at the same rate, the same time. You've got inertia and mass equalization to calculate and all that. In other words, was Pluto a globed mega civilization which went through this extraordinary destruction? And are the arcologies that we're seeing actually migrant city-sized spacecraft that landed because Pluto still had resources? And the kind of stuff, the kind of object we see as the Pyramid Mountain on Ceres is in fact one of many designs of the same scale that could carry millions or maybe billions of people from place to place in the system, if not beyond.
And where are these actually at the time? You know, right now it's freezing there, but at one time, who knows what parts? You know, like here on Earth, we've kind of moved around, and where the ice wasn't, we've moved ourselves around.
Well, but what I'm saying, Will, I don't know whether you're part of our earlier conversation. I'm saying that Pluto may have been moved from where Ceres currently is in the asteroid belt when the sun was brighter. It would have been warmer out there. Earth would have been too warm. Venus too warm. Mercury too warm. But by the time you got to the asteroid belt where Ceres is, where there used to be a big planet and lots of moons like Ceres and maybe Charon, temperatures were nice and balmy and terrestrial, as we think of terrestrial now. Then the war happened. The sun suffered. When you blow a planet up in the hyperdimensional model, you actually reduce the luminosity of the star it used to orbit. So the habitable zone shrinks. Suddenly all this stuff becomes cold. The only surviving habitable planet is Earth. Refugees come here, and we have these dim, distant memories of when there was the fall. Are we looking, gentlemen, at the reason for the fall?
Could possibly.
Fascinating. Yeah, fascinating. That image, number 12, that we've got up... at the top part of it, I love that it still is very pristine, even to where under these structures, because it's at that Terminator line. When I took this, I spun the major image around, the big, huge, full Pluto image around, and took it by the Terminator. You can see the shadows under these. I mean, this is very pristine.
Well, let me propose the following idea. Like Iapetus, if Pluto was subjected to the first blast wave of the explosion of planet, you know, 5, and half of it was sandblasted and the other half was preserved, Remember, the side we walked up on with all the geometry, the side that Bob Harrison sent me two amazing images of this afternoon, graphics, that I hope are somewhere on your Sidonia Quest site, Bob. That tells me, in, together with the crescent image, the look-back image we've been looking at, together with this image, when you rotate and you actually spin the full Pluto image upside down, this is what you get along that limb. Are we looking at the edge, the demarcation between the destroyed side of Pluto, where we're scraped down to the mantle, and the preserved Trantor side, just peeking over that terminator, which still is basically in good condition after how many millions and millions and millions of years?
That's a interesting you brought up those images I sent you, Richard, because remembering back when we were in correspondence about the last image that New Horizons took of the far side, we were discussing whether the sort of maze-like patterns when you enhanced that low-resolution image, you're getting the whether it was 3D or not, or just color variations. And what we're able to guess now from the flyby side is it's probably 3D. So so the far side, a lot of it seems to be covered
in this type of geometry.
With that type of geometry, crossing troughs and ridges, creating a maze-like
now,
pattern.
About this. Think about this. Stern has sent his spacecraft 3-plus billion miles, almost 4 billion miles, over almost 10 years, to fly by a planet, a dwarf planet, 7,700 miles distant, and he flies by the side that's been destroyed that has the arcologies on it, and he doesn't fly by the side that's pristine that has all the original Trantor-type, ancient, super high-tech Type 2 civilization geometry and buildings on it. And the odds of doing that randomly are 50-50. You know, you basically get the side you fly by when you fly by. But the flyby, Keith, you'll back me up on this, is such that he's actually flown down Arcology Row, and the best high-resolution images we're going to get are going to show us the buildings on the destroyed side and the separation between the edges of this ellipse, where Pluto was sandblasted between the destroyed ellipse side and the pristine ancient side. And he's getting all of this in this mission with a flyby that was launched 10 years ago and planned 20 years ago. And how did Alan get so lucky?
Very smart man. He's a very smart man. You can tell just the top put into the backlit image. That is a special image. You don't realize that was taken as the craft flew by and it turned around and looked backwards too, so it could have that longer exposure.
And they also,
when you're looking backwards, the surface isn't running past you.
And they did it as an MBIC, that's the technical term for this camera, scan, as opposed to a snapshot. So they were able to adjust the scan rate, I think I understand, so they can compensate for the distortion in the flyby and the geometry during the however many seconds it took to scan that image. All very, 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 very pre-planned and calculated, and oh my God, how did he know what we were going to see? Because it all had to be done years ago, right?
Although if we're talking about Trantor, of course, which is the idea of the whole world covered in a city.
That's what I'm seeing, Bob. That's what I'm seeing.
Yeah, that we're getting that kind of pattern, aren't we?
So, look, hang on. You sent me some You sent me images a couple of days ago on the crescent. I think in the right-hand corner of the crescent image, the look-back image, you sent me three close-ups showing the most astonishing three-dimensional regular geometry.
Was that me?
Yes, it was you. And you called attention to it. And I looked at that image and I said, for God's sake, this is Trantor, but it's on the side that was destroyed by the blast wave as opposed to the side. I mean, the guy that got me looking at all this was, you know, dear Tom Van Plandern, our friend and colleague who's no longer with us. But he proposed to me at a DPS meeting in Pittsburgh decades ago when we just sat down to have a quick bite to eat between sessions. He said, the solar system to me looks like you had an explosion where the asteroid belt is, shrapnel went out in all directions, and depending upon the rotation rate of the various objects in the solar system, the moons, the planets, the ones with very long orbits that are tightly locked to their primary and have very slow rotation rates, like Iapetus, which is, what, 16 days. And now Pluto is 6.25 days. So if a blast wave passes, in essence, on those bodies, they're kind of like standing still. They're not really rotating because they rotate so slowly. So one side's going to be destroyed and the other side will be saved. And then, of course, later, if they still hang out in this cloud of debris, all sides will get clobbered. Pluto didn't, because Pluto is in that safe orbit, 17 degrees above the central plane. By design? I'm beginning to think so, guys.
Anyway, the point I was trying to make before is that Pluto seems to be so covered with stuff, you know, the idea of the Trantor city, that whichever side you pass by, you would catch something interesting, I think.
But one side will be pristine, kind of, and the other side is really beaten to hell in a handbasket.
When we were waiting for the closeness encounter, that we were discussing that we probably missed the most interesting side.
Well, then the question is, did they do it by design? Did Stern realize that if he took photos of the other side that shows mega planet-sized geometry and buildings, Keith, we'd all freak out and art's worst nightmare, evangelicals running amok, you know, cats and dogs living together and all of that would take place?
Could be. Could be, but I really don't think they had any control. You know, the spacecraft was on a trajectory, and it's going at a set speed.
Yeah, but of course they have brakes. They're called hydrazine thrusters. You can time exactly when you fly by a planet. You just adjust the speed, and you arrive, 3.2 days later, or earlier, depending upon if you've got fuel. Of course, getting there later is easier than getting there earlier. But in terms of a 6.4-day spin, you can decide by tweaking the trajectory, that's called mid-course corrections, you can decide exactly when and what you're going to fly by, and they chose the side we're looking at consciously, I think for a reason.
Well, for one thing, it didn't seem to matter because we still caught the arcologies.
But it depends on the scale of the shock of the system. As Bob said a moment ago, if you're looking at a whole developed planet, like the surface is Trantor, the surface is a absolutely complex geometry of manufactured stuff. There isn't a square plot of grass down there, if there were ever was a temperature where you could have, you know, grass outside. Whereas the side we're looking at is the destroyed side on which there appear to have been implanted alien mega arcologies floating down from space and just kind of finding a place to squat, to sit, like the thing on Ceres.
Well, you know, they do look kind of similar. All the conical shapes that we see there, they do look kind of similar. Sure, could be.
Keith.
Yes.
Hello? Yes, Keith.
Yes, go ahead.
Will we be in picture with the details? You've got one labeled one.
Where are we going?
Take us there.
Right. I was just wondering whether you were going to say something about the mountain that's covered, or arcology that's covered by one when you click it.
All right. We need to get to the right image, Bob.
It's number 3.
On which page? Will's page or...?
This is on Light Through the Darkness. This
okay, that's Keith's page. So we get rid of Will. Sorry, Will. And we go to number 5, A Light Through the Darkness, back at Radio with Pictures. Number 5, Radio, Light Through the Darkness. And we scroll down to what, Bob?
Image number 3.
Number 3. Going down, ladies' lingerie. garden tools. Okay, here we are. Number three, arcologies.
And Keith has numbered the arcologies, but he's also hyperlinked them. So if you click on one, are you going to cover this, Keith?
Yeah, go down to the next image below that. It's the very last one on the page.
Okay,
right. That image has numbers on it. Those numbers.
This is your clickable image.
Yes, okay. if you click those numbers, they actually bring up a details page where I kind of walk you through the stuff that I see in them, and I'm sure that many of us have seen the same things. Go to number one and just click on the one, and it opens up another page called Section 1 Details.
I think you're covering this elsewhere. You know, they've got the big mountain in the center.
We're now on Keith's big clickable image. Which number do you want us to click on?
One.
Number one.
Number one. Clicking on number one. Oh, wow.
Right. And as you move down, there's a very deep shadow behind this very big mountain near top center.
Yep.
And then in that shadow, there's this light spot, pale light spot. And there's a color, as Will, I think, was saying before, or Andrew, was saying there's a colorized version of this, the whole perspective shot. And that has, you know, color. But where's the light coming from in that? I think Keith was saying.
Well, actually, if you scroll two images down on that page, there's your color perspective view.
Oh, yes, yes.
Okay.
I covered all the bases with this one.
You did a damn good job. Now, you can see geometric detail in that shadow, and you can also see that in the light area, there seem to be three bright areas lined up. Actually, six. There's three below, brighter, and three above. Could those three above be reflections from the ones below? That looks kind of like a reflection, doesn't it? In which case, where's the reflection bouncing off of? Glass on the dark side?
Well, that's the exact thing, isn't it? Because a reflection off anything else, like the mountain, Keith has numbered this picture again. He's like, the bright spot is next to one now. But the mountain at two, you couldn't really see it reflecting a spot into the shadow. So this goes with the idea that perhaps light is getting through these mountains.
That's exactly what it is. It's what you're seeing there in that shadow behind that large arcology is a spotlight where there's a hole that somehow light manages to get from one side of this. This is two arcologies. And it's getting from one side all the way through to the other and spotlighting that little area that's in the shadow.
There is no
other explanation.
It's got to be 10 miles. How is a spotlight of light from the sun coming through a mountain 10 miles thick?
Because it's not a mountain, it's an arcology. This is a glass or a some sort of fuller structure. You know how Fuller makes the geodesic domes?
Yep.
This is some type of, and if you look at it up close in the details, you can actually see that honeycomb kind of effect that gossamer light shining through it is showing us.
That's what it looks like to me. Okay, hold it there, guys. This is just amazing. I mean, even to me, this is amazing. I've kind of contemplated, I've imagined this kind of a day when we would see structures on other planets given to us by NASA, and there'd be little, if any, doubt based on what they look like, based on the physics of how they're constructed, based on where they were, all of which appears to have come together in this mission, the New Horizons mission, which is giving us a window on a past that of such unimaginable scale and majesty that all we can do is contemplate it on the other side of midnight. And we are back on the other side of midnight. My name is Richard C. Hoagland, and my guests this morning are Will Farrar, Robert Harrison, Andrew Currie, Keith Laney. And during the break, Andrew sent me a note. He says, couple of points that RCH made need correcting. Andrew, correct away, please.
No, not correcting, connecting.
Okay. It says correcting on my screen, but then I have a weird, computer, so by all means, connect the dots.
Okay, I want to go back to radio with pictures.
Okay.
And then we'll go back to my imagery.
Okay, which one?
I'd like to go now down to number 9.
Number 9. Number 9. Oh my God. Mr. Currie, you have a very, very vivid imagination, which happens to coincide with reality, so please continue.
Well, again, Richard, the thing that really kind of confused me is that it's kind of what you talked about, that we have a surface that's literally made of construction. It's just construction. And then we have these domed arcologies. And there's this, so there's this huge dichotomy going on. And it's very interesting how you said maybe these are we're liftable spaceships. Mm. Because one of the qualities that I've noticed, especially with the series one I did, which is side by side with Keith's image work, is these arcologies almost have like a barnacle-like quality to them.
Well, they have a very definite perimeter, and there's geometry at the perimeter, like there were huge, you know, airlocks or doors or hangar doors or entry points and exit points. But they don't look organic, as meaning part of the landscape. They appear to have a definite beginning and end, like they were plopped down.
Oh,
I love the pyramid there on the bottom right.
Yeah, and again, these are the kind of shapes that when I was scanning them and drawing them and rendering them and contemplating them, there's just no way I could have come up with this kind of imagery, and so quickly as well, might I add.
But, well, see, Richard, what I find is stunning is I'm looking at this, and this is what I see when I look at the actual pictures.
Yeah,
this is what I see. Now, you and I have not really compared notes, and again, none of the guys that we've been sending images around and we've going, ooh, and ah, and oh, have you seen this? And, but we really haven't hung over each other's shoulders and carefully crafted our stories so they all fit. So again, this is independent confirmation of what we're all seeing separately. And we're seeing what's there, and it's not, sorry, Alan, it's not ice mountains floating up through seas of liquid nitrogen.
Exactly. And Richard, the thing you said earlier, which is what I meant by connecting, is on this flyover, as I opened up with when I said it was so beautiful, it's such a beautifully composed photograph. And I really tend to agree with you that I wonder if they knew what was there before they went there.
Well, let me throw this out. And some people say I interrupt too much, because if I don't interrupt, I'm going to forget a train of thought. You know, when you got to my age, if you don't say it, you'll lose it. If there's a secret space program, with anti-gravity and, you know, hovering spaceships and deep black, you know, kind of like Hydra on steroids. If there is a secret space program bopping around the solar system, either from Earth or from the breakaway civilization, you can't imagine there are not key folks in NASA that A, know it exists, and B, have gotten some data slipped to them from it. So they can replicate with our primitive, dumb 1960s technology what the secret space program guys can bop out and look at in an afternoon and take stunning selfies in front of. God, can you imagine what they look like? So the fact that we got the right side and got the right close-ups and the right angle and all that, no, I do not think, after all these decades of doing this, this is coincidental. This is part of a disclosure plan. My thoughts.
Exactly. So if we could kind of trace what you just said, I want to go back to radio with pictures, so if everybody could go back to that.
Okay.
And we're going to go to my last image, which is number 10.
Oh, yes, number 10.
And I call this the desolate coast.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, Andrew. You've captured it.
Okay, now your reaction right there is exactly what I'm talking about. Keith and I, early on, I was screen sharing with him, and we were moving around the landscape trying to figure out, you know, angles and what we were seeing. And one of the things that I said to him, and it happened again, Richard, when you started to speak from his website, is the hair in the back of my neck went up. There is such a deep for me at least, an emotional feeling. And I'm telling you that I know this may sound a little silly, but there's been a few times, and I even said it to Keith, and Keith, you might want to chip in, but I know even you said you're a bit of a hardened battler here, but even you felt something. Remember you said that, Keith?
Oh, yes. I'm quite jaded. I've seen every stunning anomaly that's come down the pike for a decade and a half now. And these right here did move me. Yes, the whole scene moved me. Enough so that I wanted to walk around down there.
Yeah, and this is the thing, is that there's been a couple of times where guys and Richard, I'm going to tell you, I've almost been moved to tears. And I mean that by this exquisite desolation, this exquisite destruction. It is haunting and it is moving. And it goes back to what you said, Richard, about the fall and the memory of that, which you've talked about a number of times now. Do you remember that?
Yeah, of course. And that's what I feel that we're looking at.
Yeah. And
nothing more, nothing less. This is the fall.
Yeah. And with Stern and his crew so calculatingly going over this, how can you not look at this image and be moved? How can you not understand the implications of this for all of us on this planet?
Hold it there. I want to bring in a surprise guest tonight. Alan Sturm is an imaging guy who I have met recently through Ross. I think you know Keith, and Keith knows you from some years back. The reason I wanted Alan to come tonight and not be part of the show but to be a commentator is he's been watching and listening and going through the imagery before he is ready to come on. And I want you, with your degree in architectural design, to tell us your impressions of what you're seeing.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Thanks for having me on. Am I there?
You're on.
Okay. Yeah, you know, I'm finding this quite an interesting conversation. And I'm on this fence between believing NASA and believing everything that you guys are saying.
You mean you're not believing your lying eyes? You really think NASA trumps your own engineering perception?
No.
Okay.
No, my approach is always trying to take every side possible and never throwing any one thing out. So I'll tell you, when I look at this photograph, I get a similar impression to what I'm hearing, is that it's just awe-inspiring, first of all.
So you see architecture?
I see, for lack of better words, an ancient Jurassic Park, I guess you could say. It looks organic and it looks alive. And when I split apart the images, and I just started analyzing these pictures, when I split apart the pictures into different spectral analyses, you can see the different layers of the atmosphere and the back glow and the ambient occlusion shadowing that's going on. And I find it just fascinating. I was just working on some pictures while you guys were talking, and I was going to try to throw those up there.
Hmm. Well, if we don't make it tonight, we can make it tomorrow or next week. We're going to obviously come back to this. Have you ever been to Arcosanti?
I've driven by. No, I haven't.
Oh, you haven't been
visited.
In? Arcosanti was the terrestrial model pilot project that the architect, Paolo Soleri, started out in the Arizona desert about two-thirds of the way between Flagstaff and Phoenix. Mm-hmm. To the eastern side of Route 17. If you stop and you go through it, he's designed all his architecture out of concrete, not glass. But it has the same organic feel of half shells and clamshells and swirling curves and, you know, Mobius strips and phi angles and pi angles. And it has the same organic feel out of concrete on a much tinier scale. I mean, like 1/1,000,000th of this scale.
Mm-hmm.
But it feels like what we're seeing. It feels like Pluto.
It does. It when I first saw the Pluto pictures, I thought like this Dr. Seuss landscape. it has an architecture to it and an organic quality
to it.
What
did Stern tell us on the show months ago? He said Pluto has a science fiction surface. What geologist, what planetary guy in his right mind would describe any planet as having a science fiction surface unless it's Trantor?
Yeah, I didn't expect to hear that at the beginning of the show. That was kind of interesting.
We try to do things that people don't expect here. Phones included, yes. So, okay, can you tell me, you know where the images are. You want to take us to any particular image and describe from an architectural point of view what you're seeing?
I would want to hear more about Keith, what he's pointing out, and if we could hit some of his images. I saw some things in there where he had some diagrams, and I thought those would be pretty interesting to comment on.
Keith, take it away.
Sure. Let's see. We were on detail. We were on section one detail. If you go back to the link number 5 on Radio with Pictures.
Radio with Pictures, link number 5, A Light Through the Darkness.
Mm-hmm. And scroll down to the bottom of the page, and then you come across that giant click map image.
You realize you're sounding like Pope Francis, A Light Through the Darkness. Okay.
Well, you know, it's kind of a theme if you see the headings on the page.
Okay, where are we going? Where are we going?
Okay, just go back to section one detail. It's the number one. Arcology. Just click on it.
The big wide-angle image.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I want to draw your attention over to on the second image or image number 2 on that page. Okay. You'll see number 3 over there on the left-hand side of the image. Okay. It is a bright white building that's shining with its own light, light shining through it. You can see it has a rectangular base and a triangular spire on top of it. It's pretty amazing.
Oh, my gosh, yes.
And if you scroll down to the picture image, mm-hmm. I mean the color image that's mm-hmm. down at the bottom of the page, it's even more lit up. At first, I was kind of averse to this color image because, it's false color, and it was such a weird overlay situation with this backlit image for mm-hmm. it to be laid on it properly. Mm-hmm. But it's turned out to show a tremendous amount of detail, more so than the black and whites on the mm-hmm. surface.
Well, yeah, because we're used to seeing color, and even if it's not the super accurate color, it's the contrasting color that brings out the fine scale geometry.
Yes, it sure is.
That white thing looks like a shattered glass four-sided pyramid with layers, with floors, with.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you got to realize, as small as this is on the image, you know, that thing's still 3/4 mile wide. You know, it's pretty big.
It's aircraft carrier size.
Yeah, but that's sitting out here drawing. You know, it's almost self-luminescent. You know, and we see the spotlight behind the arcology.
Does this remind you of the Ossiter City lights on Ceres?
Sure, it's lit up.
So, could it be taking light, amplifying it, and pumping it out like fluorescence?
Either that or we're still looking at this feeble sunlight from 3.5 billion miles away. Mm. And this thing is glowing bright. So it's got such a high albedo that it's just off the scale, or it's self-luminescent. Yeah, one of the two. But before we get too far gone in time here, because this is a big subject and I've detailed, I mean, there's like, there's 5 detail pages that are taken from within this image. Go ahead and click off of that and go back to the main image map on the light to darkness page. You should just click off of here and it should be the next thing.
Okay. Yeah, we're back to that, the annotated big image.
Mm-hmm. And go to click area 2.
Area 2. Mm-hmm. Got it.
Okay. Now we're looking at this diamond shape, a group of domes.
Hmm.
And let's see. You can see it on the overhead image that is right beside on image number 1 on the page. Mm-hmm. It has the two opposite views.
Oh, and you scroll over to the right, and you can see it from the top down, looking down in the approach shots.
Right. So you see that the oblique view has given us way more detail. But of course, for one reason, it's a lot closer.
Yeah.
But for another thing, it's at that angle with the light shining through it and backlit. So, we're seeing stuff in those shadows. Once again, if you look near the center of that image, you see there's a conical arcology with like 4 domes around it.
Yep.
Okay. Now,
and it seems to have a bright reflection on the top and then like windows, but they're not windows. They're huge. They've got to be like, 1,000 feet across or something mm-hmm. on this scale?
Well, if you scroll down to like if you scroll down to number two, it's a little bit larger of an image with numbers on it, so you can kind of number four looks like a or number three. Number three is of real interest.
Yeah, I was looking at number six. That's the one I'm looking at.
Oh yes,
look at that.
And, you know, yeah, that's cellular construction. That
yeah, six caught my eye big time.
Well, if you look just to the right of that cellular construction,
yeah,
there's a round thing that looks like a revolver, like you know where you put your bullets in on a revolver.
Yeah.
Do you see that thing? I mean, it's a big round thing with six holes in it and a hole in the center.
So the object between nine and six, there's like a almost like a flat platform effect with like a spherical shape sitting right in the middle of it.
Yes, that's kind of like behind those two,
right?
That number nine is, and you notice the two at number nine are really similar.
Look at number five.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the top of number five.
Yeah, it's almost like glowing.
Yeah, and with that polished dome.
That's
got to be a specular reflection.
Well, look behind it at the domes behind it. They're clearly in ambient light.
Yeah.
They're not
yeah.
in there. You know, where's this light coming from that is obliterating these shadows, especially on that one?
See, the first thing I thought of when I saw this image was, boy, we got a lot of ice around, and there's a lot of kickback, and you're looking at backscattering from the bright illuminated, you know, stuff that we're not seeing the sun side. So the shadowed side of these things is seeing kickback. But then you start looking at the geometry, like number two, and there's no nearby surfaces to light up that shadow other than light coming through the mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Miles of ice. Miles of solid ice. I mean, anybody ever hung out in the Antarctic where you see icebergs? You never see icebergs, even in broad daylight, where the shadowed side is glowing because sunlight comes through the iceberg, and the iceberg is, what, a few hundred feet wide, thick.
And the sun here is much brighter, too. You brought up number two, so I'm going to point out something that is, to me, as obvious as a slap in the face.
Mm-hmm.
Right above the two, you see two rows of tiered openings.
Mm-hmm.
What is this?
Well, I think that we're looking at the destroyed sides.
Right. Well, we're seeing into this thing through those holes.
Yeah, exactly. No, there's no question. We're looking at structures which are not pristine. They're so big and so massive that there's so much left that it does kind of look, if you look quickly, pristine, but it's not.
Well, if you look, number three is a huge, man, this thing is, this is like five super domes put together or larger. But it's a great big dome structure, and it's cracked all the way down the middle of the with a big hole right in the center of it. Imagine looking down into that thing. That's just remarkable.
But we can. All we have to do is what? Scroll up and right. There we are.
Mm-hmm.
And you can look down in it.
But of course, that image is, you know, that image doesn't show it that well because it was from much further away in the opposite view. It's good for orientation though. They took that great big whole planetary image, and I've been working with it because it is so much to deal with, and that thing is incredible. It has.
You mean the full disk color image?
Yeah, the whole full disk color image. It has everything we're looking at on it in fine detail, and it is a very good quality image. And so be looking for more to come out of this area because that image is covered up with anomaly.
So where do you think Alan's going to go next? I mean, how much more can he give us before, you know, Yahoo goes nuts?
I want him to give us the pictures straight up Arcology Road.
Yeah.
I mean, we've got pictures of before and after, you know, coming toward it, and we've got pictures after they left it. All right, well, so we know they flew right over it. Where are those at?
We've got about 5 or 6 minutes left, gentlemen. It's the end of the week. It's the end of the morning. Wow. Why don't we come and kind of summarize our thoughts about this pending Stern's next image release?
Well, this light through the darkness study that I've done here, it covers several more pages.
Mm-hmm.
So, I suggest for, you know, anybody that's interested in this, go back to that first page and the click map and go through all these and look around and read the descriptions on it here. Because I spent pretty much a week and a half strolling around this surface looking at everything. And it's pretty well detailed. Add to it your own, because I know I did not find everything at all.
Anybody else?
Well, with that being said, the color image too, as well, is the whole disk image is some of the best resolution I think we've gotten out of NASA in a very long time. you can spend a lot of time pulling some things up in that, especially if you up the resolution just a tad. You don't lose much. You don't get a lot of artifacts, image artifacts. You get an awful lot of artifacts down there on the ground and architecture. But I think that's where we're going to be. Hopefully we'll get some more images like that and Arcology Row.
Well, next Thursday. I mean, he's been doing regular image dumps on Thursday just before the end of the week. Bob, what are your thoughts? Bob is
thinking. Bob's on anymore.
Bob, are you with us? Did we lose Bob? Oh, my God.
Sorry, Richard. Oh, there you are. I'm still on mute.
Okay. That happens all the time.
Yes. I was just going to say I'm inspired to put up some pages on my website about Pluto.
Terrific.
I've been holding back because of the slowness of which they've been coming back from New Horizons. So I think the time to just do tasters on it has come.
Well, when you're done, obviously you'll send me an email and I will tell everybody on the show and we'll go look at what you your considered thoughts. Any sneak previews?
Well, I think I'll use the theme of the Trantor scene. So explore the images through that idea. So those two images that you were talking about at the beginning of the show, certainly I'll start off with them.
Okay. Andrew?
Yeah, Richard, just again, the way this is composed, it looks planned, and the lack of feeling for this tells me that somebody is familiar with this landscape and
well,
knew exactly what they were going to get.
I don't quite understand. You said the lack of feeling. What do you mean?
Well, as I say, when you look into this, there is just the sense of humanity of what's seeing this disaster and the way that NASA's behaving. It they've seen this before. They knew this was coming, and they're accustomed to it. It's like looking at a car crash. A few minutes later, you're not as affected by it.
Oh,
it's just
I
a
see.
Feeling.
I see. Okay. Well, your 3D rendering certainly will help people get their eyes used to what's in these images. But obviously, I recommend going back and forth and hovering a lot on the real imagery, on what Keith has done, what Will has done. Alan, what are your final thoughts?
You know, I'm hoping for stereo imagery and more color images. And I think that given the fact that if they were blasting past this thing faster than bullets and they were capable of doing a scanline resolution style photo, looking back behind as they're speeding towards the 10th planet out there in the Kepler belt, then I'm guessing that they can do the same thing, that they could orthocorrect these and give us some stereo imagery and we could actually get some real depth out of this stuff. And I really would hope that they would start posting images that weren't that had no compression in them, at least PNGs, because I'm sure it's coming back raw.
Well, they were telling us in these long delayed broadcasts that we're going to get uncompressed imagery after they downlinked a lot of compressed imagery, you know, close in. Keith, what do you think the odds are that Stern is going to up the ante next Thursday?
Well, you know, since we detailed all this this week, he'll probably up the ante pretty high next week.
Hey, you know, one other thing that I would want to find out is, you know, these are multispectral images. You know, that's red, blue, and infrared,
plus other filters, other colors that we're not seeing.
Yeah, and it's like, and that is a confusing view to our eyes because this is not what Pluto would look like if we were hovering in orbit around it, and so it's almost, you know, like trying to mix regular photography with X-ray, with sonar,
well,
with
there,
all kinds
there
of
is,
other things.
As you know, there is a way that they've been able over the years, if they only had filters that were like blue or red, they can make a synthetic green by doing some subtraction. And I saw somebody over on unmannedspaceflight.com. I think his name is Maki. Keith, you probably know him. And he did a corrected view, throwing out one of their filters and substituting his synthetic green, and it's very provocative.
Yeah, that's what I would like to see. I would like to get the actual channels that are sent back, you know, and then well, look at those individually.
If you crawl around the New Horizons website, there may be images or image data like that. Have you ever found anything like that, Keith?
No, they're taking the Ralph color images that are on there and overlaying them. That one was done with the false color, you know, because they have the ones that are supposedly true color, and then they have the false color ones that are much more brightly colored with the variations.
Well, gentlemen, unfortunately, we could go on another hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. Keith would kill me, and then there'd be no show on Tuesday morning, because we have reached the end of the week and the end of the show. I want to thank my guests this morning, Will Farrar, Robert Harrison, Andrew Currie, Keith Laney, and surprise commentator Alan Sturm. This, gentleman, is only the beginning. I believe we're going to be getting stunning additional imagery. I think this is part of a disclosure plan. In the best of all possible worlds, NASA's major announcement vis-a-vis Mars may actually hook in and connect with what they're finding at the other end of the solar system at Pluto. Well, that will all be resolved at the next stage of this unfolding drama. Same time, same bat channel, next week, next Tuesday morning. Until then, you're leaving the other side of midnight. You're entering into a long journey. So just remember, third star on the left, straight on, till morning.